I Had Trouble in Getting to Sala Salu, written and illustrated by Dr. Seuss.
I was real happy and carefree and young, and I lived in a place called the Valley of Vung.
And nothing, not anything ever went wrong.
Until, well, one day I was walking along.
I guess I got careless, I guess I got gawking at daisies and not looking where I was walking.
And that's how it started.
Sock, what a shock.
I stubbed my big toe on a very hard rock.
And I flew through the air.
And I went for a sail.
And I sprained the main bone at the tip of my tail.
Now, I never had ever had troubles before.
So I said to myself, I don't want any more.
If I watch out for rocks with my eyes straight ahead,
I'll keep out of trouble forever, I said.
But watching ahead, well, it just didn't work.
I was watching those rocks. Then I felt a hard jerk.
A very fresh green-headed Quilligan quail sneaked up from in back and went after my tail.
And I learned there are troubles
of more than one kind.
Some come from ahead.
And some come from behind.
So I said to myself,
now I'll just have to start
to be twice as careful
and be twice as smart.
I'll watch out for trouble in front and back sections by aiming my eyeballs in different directions.
I found this to be quite a difficult stunt,
but now I was safe both in back and in front.
The new troubles came
from above
and below.
A scritch at my neck
and a skink at my toe.
And now I was really in trouble, you know.
The rocks
and the quail
and the scritch
and the skink.
I had so many troubles, I just couldn't think.
There I was, all completely surrounded by trouble,
when a chap rumbled up in a one-wheeler wobble.
Young fellow, he said, what has happened to you?
Has happened to me and to other folks, too.
So I'll tell you what I have decided to do.
I'm off to the city of Sala Salu,
on the banks of the beautiful River Wahoo,
where they never have troubles, at least very few.
It's not very far.
And my cane was strong.
He'll get us there fast.
So hop on, come along.
I jumped up behind him.
Then all through the day,
the wobble wobbed on
in a wobblesome way.
The road got more bumpy, more rocky, more tricky. By midnight, I tell you, my stomach felt icky.
And so I said, mister, please, when do we get to that wonderful town? Aren't we almost there yet?
Young fellow, he told me, don't start into stew. At sunrise, we'll drive into Sala Salu.
And you'll have no more troubles. I promise I do.
But when dawn finally came,
and the darkness got light,
the wonderful city was nowhere in sight.
Instead of the city, we ran into trouble.
Our camel got sick, and he started to bubble.
We had to pull him in the one-wheeler wobble.
So there we were in a dreadful position. Our camel sure needed a camel physician.
Now doctors for camels are not often seen,
especially on mountains or far, far between.
But we pulled that old wobble and set out to find
some doctor while dragging our camel behind.
I pulled, pulled, and pulled. Then the next thing I knew,
I was pulling the camel and wobble chap too.
Now really, I thought this is rather unfair.
But he said, don't you stew. I am doing my share.
This is called teamwork. I furnish the brains. You furnish the muscles, the aches, and the pains. I'll pick the best roads, tell you just where to go.
And we'll find a good doctor more quickly, you know.
Then he sat and he worked with his brain and his tongue.
And he bossed me around just because I was young.
He told me go left, then he told me go right. And that's what he told me all day and all night.
Next morning we woke up Dr. Sam Snail, who knew all about tonsils and camels as well.
Our camels, he said, had a bad case of gleeks and should lie flat in bed for at least 20 weeks.
I was tired, how I wanted to crawl in that bed.
But the wobble chap sent me away and he said,
your troubles are practically odd and
just run down that hill and around the next bend
and you'll come to the Happy Way bus route, my friend.
The Happy Way bus leaves at 4:42.
And will take you directly to Sala Salu,
on the banks of the beautiful River Wahoo,
where they never have troubles, at least very few.
Well, the bus stop was there,
and that part was just fine.
But tacked on a stick was a very small sign,
saying, notice to passengers using our line.
We are sorry to say that our driver, Butch Myers,
ran over four nails and has punctured all tires.
So until further notice, the 442 cannot possibly take you to Sala Salu.
But I wish you a most pleasant journey by feet. Signed, Bus Line President, Horace P. Sweet.
And that Horace P. Sweet almost ruined my feet.
100 miles later, my feet was so sore. Then when you know it, it started to pour.
I was drenched to the skin.
When a chap in a slicker
splashed up and he yelled,
"It's the midwinter jigger."
The midwinter jigger came early this year,
and it's not going to be
very comfy around here.
Any fool would get out, so I packed up my things. And I'm off to my granddaddy's out in Palm Springs.
"Take cover," he yelled. "Use my house if you wish."
Then the chap in the slicker splashed off like a fish.
I ran in the house and fell in a heap. I needed a rest, but I just couldn't sleep.
Did you ever sleep when your feet were like ice?
With a family of owls and a family of mice.
I listened all night to the growls and the yowls.
And the chattering teeth of those mice and those owls.
While the midwinter jigger howled horrible howls.
I tossed and I flipped and I flopped and I flipped. It was 5:15 when I finally slept.
Then I dreamed I was sleeping on billowy billows of soft silk and satin marshmallow-stuffed pillows.
I dreamed I was sleeping on Sala Salu.
On the banks of the beautiful River Wahoo, where they never had troubles, at least very few.
Then I woke up and it just wasn't true.
I was crashing downhill in a fabulous flood with suds in my eyes and my mouth full of mud.
And my nose full of water and my ears full of shrieks of the owls flying off with mice on their beaks. And I said to myself, now I really don't see
why troubles like this have to happen to me.
I floated 12 days with that toothpaste or soap. I practically almost had given up hope.
When someone up high shouted, "Here, catch the rope."
Then I knew that my troubles had come to an end and I climbed up the rope calling, "Thank you, my friend."
I got to the top, but it wasn't a friend, and I saw that my troubles were not at an end.
A big man on a horse scared me out of my wits. He bellowed, "I'm General Genghis Khan Schmitz."
There's a war going on, and it's time that you knew.
Every lad of the land has a duty to do.
We're marching to battle. We need you, my boy.
We're about to attack. We're about to destroy.
The perilous poozer of Pumplemoose Pass.
So get into line. You're a private first class.
He gave me a shooter
and one little bean, which was not very much,
if you see what I mean.
Then he yelled, "Get that poozer, attack without fear.
The glorious moment of victory is near."
And the glorious general led the advance
with the glorious swish of his sword and his lance
and a glorious clank of his tin-plated pants.
Then we went around a corner and found out, alas,
there was more than one poozer and Pumplemoose Pass.
And Genghis Khan Smith shouted out to his men.
This happens in war every now and again.
Sometimes you are winners, sometimes you are losers.
We never can win against so many poozers.
And so I suggest that it's time to retreat.
And the army raced off on its tin-plated feet.
There I was with more poozers than I'd ever seen.
There I was with my shooter and only one bean.
There I was and I thought, will I ever get through
to the wonderful city of Sala Salu?
On the banks of the beautiful River Wahoo, where they never have troubles, at least very few.
I had terrible troubles in staying alive.
Then I saw an old pipe that said vent number 5.
I didn't have time to find out what that meant.
But the vent had a hole and the hole's where I went.
Well, that vent where I went
was a sort of a funnel
that led me down into
a frightful black tunnel.
The traffic down there was endless, I must say,
with billions of birds going all the wrong way.
They bumped me with bikes and they banged me with dishes.
I ran into ladders, beds, bottles, and fishes.
I skidded on garbage.
I fell in a horn.
Troubles, I wish I had never been born.
I was down there 3 days in that bird-filled-up place. At least 8,000 times I fell smack on my face. I injured 3 fingers, both thumbs, and both lips, my shin bone, my backbone, my wishbone, and hips.
What's more, I was starved.
I had nothing to eat.
And damp, was it damp? I grew moss on my feet.
Then just when I thought I could stand it no more, by chance I discovered a tiny trap door.
I put my head out, the gray sky was sky blue.
And I knew from the flowers
I'd finally come through
to the banks of the beautiful River Wahoo.
I couldn't be far now from Sala Salu.
There it was, with its glittering towers in the air.
I made it, I'd done it, at last I was there.
And I knew that I left all my troubles behind.
When a chap at a doorway that shimmered and shined
waved me a wave that was friendly and kind.
Welcome, he said as he gave me his hand.
Welcome, my son, to this beautiful land.
Welcome to sweet, sunny Sala Salu,
where we never have troubles, at least very few.
As a matter of fact, we have only just one.
Imagine just one little trouble, my son.
And this one little trouble, as you will now see.
Is this the one little trouble I have with this key?
There is only one door into Sala Salu.
And we have a key slapping slippered.
We do.
This troublesome slipper
moved into my door
2 weeks ago, Tuesday at 3:45.
Since then, I can't open this door anymore.
And I can't kill the slipper. It's very bad luck.
To kill any slipper, and that's why we're stuck.
And why no one gets in, and town's gone to pot.
Oh, it's a terrible state of affairs, is it not?
And so, said the doorman
of Sala Salu,
my job at the door here is finished. I'm through.
And I'll tell you what I have decided to do.
I'm leaving, he said, leaving Sala Salu on the banks of the beautiful River Wahoo, where we never have troubles, at least very few.
And I'm off to the city of Bula Bubal on the banks of the beautiful River Wuwal, where they never have troubles, no troubles at all.
Come on along with me, he said as he ran.
And you'll never have any more troubles, young man.
I'd have no more troubles.
That's what the man said.
So I started to go.
But I didn't.
Instead,
I did some quick thinking inside of my head.
Then I started back home to the Valley of Vung. I know I'll have troubles. I'll maybe get stung.
I'll always have troubles. I'll maybe get bit
by that green-headed quail on the place where I sit.
But I've bought a big bat.
I'm already, you see.
Now my troubles are going to have troubles with me.
So what do you think this story means?
What moral can we find and glean?
Everyone has troubles, big and small.
There's no place that has no troubles at all.
We have to be strong and kind and brave.
We can't choose our troubles, but can choose how to behave.
We can be proactive and choose our weather.
And synergize to solve our problems together.
Put first things first, do work, then play.
Listen to others and what they say.
Set a goal and make a plan.
Then you will find success, young man.
Keep doing your best every day.
Shine on, stars, and lead the way.